Terry Crews was in Training Day.
Terry Crews is looking hard. He's the one that takes the gun.
Nah, go on, man.
Tyler Perry would have hired Terry Crews for sure.
Every day, all day. Terry Crews would have been dark evil nigga like three times and then finally got a hero role.
I don't know. He just seems like a real nice nigga.
But look what they did to him in Training Day.
Yeah, you're right. Like, you're right.
But he was flipping pigeons, man.
I must have recently watched Training Day.
No, nigga, I just love Training Day. What up, everybody? It's the Well Spoken Token coming at you again with another episode. Whoa. Okay, guys. I know it's been a while. And, you know, the last time you heard me, I was like, yeah, there's going to be streams. There's going to be, you know, you guys are used to this by now. I mean, at this point, we have taken so many hiatuses, taken so many breaks, gone on full on deadpan silence, you know, ghost mode, all that good shit, vanish mode, whatever naughty bits you're using to sneak around your, you know, significant others, all that good stuff. Yeah, that's us. That's me. I gotta let you guys know it's been a rough little bit of time. I've been stuck at my mom's crib. You know, I've been in limbo as far as the housing situation, but we are finally in a new space. As you can see, it's another area. It's not quite as decorated. There's not as many lights and stuff right there. I mean, of course, that's only if you're watching us on YouTube, which you should be if you want to. If you wanted to see my face, if you wanted to love on me and my brother in the comment section, you could do that on YouTube. But if you're listening to this purely audio, then it's like, what do you mean, nigga? It sounds exactly the same. Guess what, guys? All the setup is usually the same. The setting is just different. Guess what, though? One thing that I always have with me as much as I possibly can, it's my brother. Say what up to the people, bro.
That was a sloppy ass fucking intro. I didn't even realize you were trying to introduce me. Yeah, but anyway, hey, what's up, y'all? I'm back. Virgil Hawkins here. You know, It's very hard. It's hard to go by Virgil. I'm gonna be honest.
Of course, man. You got to think back to the great grandparent shit like that.
It doesn't click to me like, oh, that was your internet persona. That's your internet persona right there.
That's what you were rapping under. That's crazy. You were just out here like, now I'm you're a man's in the military. You've been back and forth. You got
news.
I don't know if we're talking about that. You know, keep that in mind. Get to it more. You know, later and shit like that. Yes, it was a sloppy intro because I had to come and let the people know kind of what was going on. I didn't want people to feel like, you know, I was like, oh shit, maybe these niggas done got into an argument and now they can't fucking pod anymore.
Oh no. I can't stay mad at you, nigga. You know, I can't. Of course. Even in the darkest moments, I'm like, I gotta pod. I gotta fuck with my boy.
Gotta get with the mans. Now I'm glad to have you back, man. Welcome back to America's soil. It's always good to have you return home.
I never left America.
I mean, you didn't. Were you on the soil, nigga?
Yeah, I was. I wasn't like physically feet on the soil, but I was here.
Yeah,
I was in the area.
You were in the area code of America. America.
Yeah, right. I was in the American area code.
Hey, are we one?
Which like, is one?
It's literally America is one. One. How did we make that? How did we get?
I don't fucking know, nigga. I don't know. I don't even know who to talk to figure that out.
Alexander Graham Bell, the inventor of the telephone, the nigga.
He is the inventor of the telephone. He was definitely not the inventor of the area code. I think
Hold on. It's different. Ludacris. It's got to be Ludacris.
Yeah, it's got to be Ludacris.
He had hoes, different area codes. That's definitely the man who invented area codes. Yeah,
Ludacris definitely did that.
He was like, yeah, America won. Who's two? That's what.
I don't know.
Is it Canada?
So, or funny enough, right? So, like, there's a food delivery app called Talabot that is way better than Uber.
Okay.
Like Uber Eats and DoorDash and shit, because they keep pulling up on the little scooters and shit.
Shoot us in the motherfucking Uber Eats foot. Like, what if Uber Eats wanted to? You know,
I don't think they want to. They not fucking with us, nigga.
I mean,
the best we got is Blue Chew, maybe. Maybe a Skillshare every now and then.
Hey, man. Maybe Raycon earbuds.
They're not going for us. When was the last time you saw a Raycon ad?
I have not seen a Raycon ad in a motherfucking minute, man.
Maybe Justin Wang gets Raycon ads, but yeah, Talabot. That's where I learned, like, oh, this is the area code for Bahrain. I'm not going to give it out because I don't remember.
Oh, but yeah, again, but basically Talabot out here giving you the actual area code for Bahrain. That's interesting as hell. I'm, again, completely baffled by error codes. Who knows who the fuck sets them? But this is the type of rabbit holes you come to expect with the well-spoken fucking token, man. So as you can also see, my brother, you moved as well, man. So like,
yeah. I moved to an apartment. Went from the townhouse to the apartment because piece of shit dude didn't want to pay his fucking mortgage.
Nah, man.
I'm out the house now. Fuck you, nigga.
Yeah, kiss my ass. Kiss our asses. Kiss our black ass.
Yeah, motherfucker. You know what I mean? And you dispersed the check. I told you, nigga, I ain't moving for free. But anyway.
Send the money. Send the bread. If you going to make
send the bread out,
nigga, send the bread. Let me know.
Send the bread. Send the loaf.
You won't see a single box moved. Not a piece.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I play ball a little bit. I try to play ball, you know, show niggas like, hey, man, I'm willing to cooperate, but I can't. I'm not finna move for free. Yeah, I know what my legal rights as a tenant are, nigga.
Nah, man, the sting's too much. The sting of this move. I gotta have something for my grievances. You know, my girl, we can't just be out here stuck.
I just refuse to move for free, especially if I don't have to. Like, yeah, you can send niggas in here. Because it was bad for a little minute. We had niggas in and out the house, all types of dumb shit. Huh. Shout out to my girl for like moving pretty much on her own. That shit had to be stressful.
Oh, yeah. But, you know, shout out to her for documenting the whole process, man. Her story is
I didn't pay wild. Attention.
I mean, how were you?
I never looked.
You barely had any signal, though.
Yeah. I was able to load like various Wikipedia articles, but I wasn't able to load like stories, shit like that. It would look like a little Nabisco chip.
Yeah, I was about to say cracker. Was most of that shit all the motherfucking please give us like 50 cents? You know, Wikipedia's not free. You know,
No.
Click away.
The beauty of having low bandwidth internet is that the ads don't load.
No, that's fucking amazing. You get classic internet before the ads, vanilla internet.
I think it always had ads. We just called them pop-ups.
Yeah, no, but like there was a time frame. It was like where the pop-ups and the ad companies had not gotten as like hyped to the situation.
Mm.
I mean, there was still advertisement, but I remember ad-free internet. Like I could go to CartoonNetwork.com and just be like on CartoonNetwork.com.
They don't need ads on CartoonNetwork.com.
No, I mean, but now they have. I bet they have ads now. I bet they're
probably. I don't know.
It's like a mother.
I don't know. Maybe it's probably just ads for like it's probably just ads for fucking the mobile app.
You know what I mean? You can get it on your fucking razor.
Yeah, right. Oh man,
you can put it on your car. You can get it on your Sidekick. When niggas watching videos on Sidekicks, was that a thing? Could you?
I don't know. I never had a Sidekick.
Actually, you know what's funny? I remember now. There's a scene in Never Back Down where like there's a recorded.
That sounds about right.
The recorded fight and everybody's looking at their phones watching this fucking fight, and now looking back I was like, there's no way in fuck that fight was in such good
there's no way in fuck that shit phones. Happened
like there's no way that's a couple of pieces of green screen tape and just somebody's just fucking zoomed in on a 2004 brick.
That's exactly what happened. Like, it's just a piece of green tape and niggas like, oh man, look at this fight. It's like nobody's really fighting.
Extras are really trying to earn.
I've seen it. They used to do that shit. They did that shit on like iCarly with like the Paraphones and all sorts of other shit.
The Paraphones are fucking hilarious, though. I'm not gonna lie. Like the fact that they got glowing.
They did that shit on Zoe 101 too. Shout out to them for getting a reboot.
Shout out to y'all for having a shared universe. Very interesting.
Yeah, what's up with the Nez Declassified fucking podcast?
Nigga, that shit, I actually started watching that like while you were gone, like right before, like as we were trying to get ready to move and shit like that, like. Literally a couple of days before, I was like, "Holy shit!" The whole podcast is like,
"Well, who's the A Mike?"
Oh, it's definitely Ned. I wish I remember that nigga's real name.
I think his name was Devin Worcestershire.
Cookie is the mall of the podcast, right? Like he's just like
he's too cool.
Yeah, kind of every now and then, but he kind of puts stuff out there because you can see that Ned is really like. There's moments where Ned is like, he almost cries. I think he is crying at one point. It's just like, you know, I really tried after this, like, and I just life was not the same. I was like,
niggas don't want a Nez Declassified fucking reboot, nigga. That's why they didn't want it.
They want that, not a reboot, but I think they want like an adulting version. Like I think they want
what?
Like,
why the fuck would I want that?
That's what they're even proposing on the
podcast. Don't get me started, nigga. Don't get me started.
Moses is the confused one, the one that's like, podcast. What?
Well, she got in trouble not too long ago over some racist shit.
I mean, she was like, the thing about Moses is that like while fucking Ned faded into obscurity and Cookie got like certain beat jobs, certain random like behind the scene jobs here and there, right? Like he started having more like success outside of like, oh, I'm in front of the camera shit. Mose had Pretty Little Liars. Like she was getting work. Like she had shit that was going on and like a cult fan base behind like that. Cause Pretty Little Liars was like, I think 9 seasons. Like,
no. I know. It was a big thing to a lot of people.
So to her, the whole I'm regular, like this whole experience, like it seems like for me, like watching her like talk with these niggas and shit like that, she's not necessarily like as down to earth. Like she hasn't had
no, she thinks she Hollywood type shit.
Not necessarily, but like you know how niggas like be so far outside the culture for a long period of time.
Oh yeah, it's
not normal. Like normally, yeah. So when people start talking, like you see them like not glaze over, but they're like,
yeah, oh, you're not interfacing with real life. You're interfacing with the parody of real
life. Exactly.
But it's been my thing for the past couple of days. But I feel you. Go ahead. Go, keep going.
The simulation.
Theory? Well, no. So I had told and I had probably said this to you earlier. I stopped saying that's cap.
Okay.
And I started saying that's LARP.
You did say that. You did tell me.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, that'll catch. Like, I like
it. Yeah. I don't think it'll catch, but like, that's LARP. And I'm seeing it in real time because niggas don't know. A lot of niggas don't know that CAP is short for caption. So, like, whenever somebody says, like, oh, that's CAP, it's like, oh, no, you're not telling the truth. You're giving me an Instagram caption. You're giving me a whatever caption, right?
Yeah.
But I'm like, exactly. But if a nigga come in and say like, oh, you know what I mean? I came in, I bopped that nigga. Bah, bah, bah. Nigga started palming all over the place. Bah, bah, bah. Hit the ground. Nigga was, right? He's not telling the truth.
He want to fuck with Hollywood Cole.
Right. He's live action role playing as a gangster that he heard about.
Once. Yeah. He was like, oh, shit, I heard about this or I saw this on one time. Like, you know, or like I watched American Gangster 3 times.
And right.
Frank Lucas was the best.
That's it. And I can probably emulate that character pretty much. I know his class. I know his stats. I can do
easy
that.
Day. Like class. I know his class. I know his stats. I've activated my Sharingan. It's no problem.
Right.
Sharingan, man. Shout out to Seven Hearts, man. That's a cold ass man. That's a cold ass.
Now fuck with them niggas, man. They good people
that
over there.
Shit is dope. That shit is dope. Also, man, I appreciate you. We've been rocking these new clothes here, man. Thanks. Shout out to Monomo. Like Monomo.
Mamono
out there in Florida, man. Y'all make this motherfucker clean in a bitch, man. This cloud motherfucking McDonald's, y'all. It's cloud chilling at McDonald's. Yeah, probably gonna get a McFlurry or something like that. But the ice cream machine is broken. He's gonna have to activate the Buster.
You know, we got the Tifa with the Taco Bell.
It's the classic Taco Bell, also not your
favorite. Yeah, remain
regal Taco Bell.
Fine ass Tifa. I can't believe Cloud didn't try to get with Tifa. That's
man. But I mean, look, man, the bow had that nigga mesmerized. He was like, oh, this is the bow in her hair, man. She's
niggas who like both weird.
It is a strange thing.
Like. Weird. Weird niggas who like Blossom's my favorite Powerpuff Girl. Like nigga, weird.
Yeah, why, nigga? Like she had a bit of an anal retentive issue. Like I don't think we really want to fuck with her as much.
Mind you, I was 6 when I was making these comments.
Like why is the like, literally? I feel like Blossom was like middle aged and she was like a preschooler. Bitch, talk like.
Well, she I mean, they were made Blossom. In a lab, so
that sounds weird. Should I say that?
I don't think they were made in. Did Professor X have a lab?
I really think that was his kitchen. It did not look like
he just had a kitchen.
It did not look like
I think him and Gucci Mane basically the same nigga.
Why is Dexter got a whole underground laboratory and fucking the professors in his kitchen like sugar, spice, everything nice? I'm making cake.
In the kitchen, rich whipping like a stir fry.
That should have, oh my God, man.
Do you want to build some human?
What I'll say is, I think Cartoon Network and the fucking strategies that they used back in the day, I think could still work now. I would love to see like Amigos, the kitchen, like with the Powerpuff Girls, but it's like him and Professor. That would be fantastic.
What are you talking about right now?
I'm saying, remember that Cartoon Network's original, like early strategy, well, not early strategies, because Cartoon Network was around for a while with like Looney Tunes and shit. But as we moved into the 90s and stuff, we started embracing things like MF Doom. We started like putting things like
that's Adult Swim primarily.
Nah, like, I mean, yes.
But if you're talking about like the group,
I'm talking about like
when Wyclef did like
exactly Wyclef. Okay. Or don't stand so close.
RIP Takeoff.
Yeah, exactly. RIP
Takeoff. Gotta give the RIP Takeoff.
Again, I just feel like that would be very interesting. I feel like there will be a lot of rappers that are receptive to that type of thing. And I think that with their fingers still on the pulse, they probably would have been able to like construct the same like awesomeness out of like Cartoon Network. I just don't think they're using the same platform.
Yeah, I don't feel like. I don't feel like that works on a network anymore. I think that has to work for the artist and only the artist.
I mean, I get it. I just like when it comes to those situations, like is the artist reaching out to the motherfucking like creator? Is the creator reaching out to the artist? Speaking of which, actually, I wanted to go ahead and speak on that because, you know, during the homeless situation, you know, I was, again, living with moms. Homeless light, because, again, you're with your mom. So, you know, just like, hey, your trash bag full of clothes.
Yeah. Nah, nigga, you did the cardinal fuck up. That's what you did. You did the cardinal fuck up.
You mean
it was like, now nah, I'm gonna get out the lease before I got a place.
Nah. You gotta understand. The one thing is right. I will own up to being like slightly unprepared, but at the same time, I was like, I've got a month out. Right. I got a month out. I've already got a couple applications in. I'm getting ready to like start this process. It shouldn't take a month, right, to get this apartment. It shouldn't take a month to get.
Don't fuck up your blessing, nigga. Exactly. Don't let them niggas see this shit.
These niggas were very weird and wild about me because I went through a whole situation, man. I'm calling corporate offices. I'm calling compliance offices. Tell me why the leasing agent looked me in my face and was just like, you know, you almost talked yourself out of an apartment.
Call no, I didn't.
And stuff. And I'm like, the fuck? Hold on, man. What the shit? These motherfuckers took 2 months to get a fucking application processed and I'm in my mom's crib. Like, I just today's the day, maybe. Maybe,
maybe tomorrow. Might be moving out tomorrow.
Wake up every day like, and my stepdad asked me about whether or not I've got this motherfucking apartment situation. He's like, no pressure at all. And I'm like, yeah, I understand there's no pressure, but every time we talk about it, it feels more and more
it
like.
It feels like pressure more and more every day. Look, nigga, I'm leaving, okay?
I swear to God, I'm leaving. And again, I know I wasn't like, that wasn't a burden, and I appreciate everything.
Oh, no, I wasn't stressed out. I wasn't stressed out for you, because usually, you know what I'm saying, if something going on with you or the younger brother or anybody else in the fam or immediate circle, I'm fucking a ball of anxiety. Like, this nigga not going to make it. He not going to go. I just, you do this thing where you make declarations.
Yeah.
Things are happening before they're actually happening.
The thing the information I was getting from these people, right, was like, all right, cool, you're good on this date, right? And I'm like, all right, cool, bet. I show up money in hand, ready to go on this date. They're like, ooh, let me see your other statement. I'm like, what the fuck? Hold on. They're like, wait. And I keep coming back to like, nah, we need more information. We need this and this. I was like, what the shit is going on, motherfucker? I mean, I guess I want to stay here, but god damn, like I done moved into motherfucking banks is worth, I mean, fucking not less hassle than this shit.
You said banks?
I did.
You moved into a bank? What the fuck are you talking about?
I mean, like getting a bank account.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, getting a bank account shouldn't be that hard.
I know some niggas.
Don't talk to me about
it. I was like, hold on. I don't have a bank account currently. I mean, I have like a couple of pay cards.
Yo, chill. Yo, chill.
This nigga said, chill. Oh, by the way, speaking of that, I have officially set up the registries for the young man, the young boy, the young king, the young prince that's coming to this world, yo. My little darling young son. I got my registry set up, yo. So I will plug those. I got to, you know, I got a platform. I got these people. They love me. They want to show me some love, or I like y'all. Y'all like me. I don't know. Let me put this down so I don't look like an asshole. Yo, I'm registered at Amazon. I'll put the link in the fucking description. I'm registered at Target. I'm going to put the link in the description. I'm also registered at Wally World. You can catch me there. Those are the three that are the main ones right here in the area. We didn't necessarily want to get too crazy outwards and shit like that. And we're not expecting anything huge, and you don't have to get me shit. If you just want to like, comment, subscribe, all that good shit, that'd be fantastic. That would show my son some love, because we're trying to get paid. Goddamn, we're trying to get paid.
Nigga, I guess that's sloppy. No comment. All right, cool. I'm ready for you, man. Good for you.
Like, yeah,
good for you, man. Yeah.
It's the way you wanted to try to get the money for your son. It's the way you want to do it.
Yeah, show some love, man. You know,
rattle the cup.
My man's baby registry is out. You know, it's in the description.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Help my man's out. You know what I mean? You know, invest in the future.
Exactly. I mean, we got 2 months. We got 2 months going. I guess
shit had to been fucking you up to have been.
Yes.
Hit bombs.
My nigga, that's what I'm saying. Like
pregnant.
I'm in this motherfucker like, hey, okay. I'm like, I gotta help her put socks on and shit. She's getting big. I love it. I love it. Every day. I was like, oh my god, my son is growing you more and more. Your belly just keeps getting bigger and bigger. And I know my baby's in there just making room. It's fucking fantastic.
I can't wait for a couple years to go by and us to get burned for that.
Yeah, this room is gonna change like totally a bunch of stuff here. But like dead ass, I'm sitting this like every day. I'm just sitting here thinking, I was like, man, it's got to be today. Like, I got to get up out of here. Every other weekend, I'm just like, oh, God. Like, is it going to be another weekend? I don't got no excuse to just sit in here for 8 hours and work. Got to go find some shit to do. But in the time frame of trying to find some shit to do, like, me and my girl actually took a lot of time to, like, go out and, like, go watch movies and shit like that. Like, we saw, like, 5 movies within the course.
Well, yeah, you got to get away from mama crib. You know what I mean? Like, you gotta do what you gotta do.
We were at
shout out to mom. We love her, but you know what I mean. Like,
yeah, appreciate you opening your doors. You know, bringing in your unborn grandson and your fucking child and his mate.
Yeah, I wouldn't call her a myth, but I feel
my companion.
You know, every now and again, you got to cash in on that shit that they be saying. It's like, if you ever need anything,
if you ever need me, the door is always open, baby.
Shit, let's see.
Always coming. You gonna see?
You about to see?
Because we're just you wait 2 months now. Time's ticking. But nah, it was pretty good, nigga. I watched Creed fucking 3. Nigga, were you aware that Ryan Coogler passed the soundtrack off to Dreamville?
That sounds terrible. That sounds like a, well, you know what? That's just a Ryan Coogler move at this point. It's like, hey man, what if y'all, a collective, did the fucking soundtrack? That'd be cool.
It was good. It's really good. I mean, because
I don't know. I've heard different things about Creed 3, but I'd love to hear.
I'm talking about the soundtrack. Now, I mean, like, I mean, everybody has their own mixed opinions about Creed, and there's some things in there that I definitely want to like talk about for sure. But right now, as far as the soundtrack goes, I don't know if you've been keeping up with each Creed soundtrack, but it's almost done. Not necessarily by each collective, but like if you look at Creed 1, right, it's a lot of like, because it's in Philadelphia, right, the mainstay of that is going to be like a Meek Mill, right? That was kind of a big thing. It was like use Meek Mill as like a driving force, and then a lot of really cool supporting artists like Vince Staples and fucking
Childish Gambino. Childish
Gambino. That's the first soundtrack, right? The second Creed soundtrack, because I didn't listen to that one as much because I was very into the first one. But the second one, I didn't listen to as much. But the third one, I was like, holy shit, it got passed off to Dreamville. Because as I'm watching the movie, right, there becomes like, you know, there's always going to be like a fucking montage in a goddamn Rocky movie. There, fucking suddenly I heard J. Cole's voice. I was like, oh, shit. Now, Kehlani made an appearance in the, like, she made a little cameo appearance as an artist.
In the movie,
yeah. Like, because, you know.
Yeah, because his wife is also an artist. And
exactly.
Shit, yeah.
Well, she's losing her hearing, so she can't necessarily. So she.
Yeah, she deaf yet?
She's not deaf, but she's pretty deaf. Like, she's.
Is she the same amount of deaf as she was in the last movie?
No, nah, she's more deaf. Like, she's.
All to right, the point cool. Where as long as y'all keep that consistent. I want Creed 5. She need to be. Completely fucking, deaf.
But the thing is that they have a, you know, they had a daughter in the second one, right? And she's deaf. Yeah,
so hereditary deaf.
Yeah, no, she's deaf. Like, yeah, that's the thing. Hereditary deaf. Learned about that.
Okay,
in,
whatever.
Well, in okay, those cool. Plays in that play. Yeah,
I guess it's like being a little person. Like, you got the deaf gene.
Just fucking
Mishima, little person. Same Mishima, thing.
Little
it's person. A crapshoot on the devil gene. The deaf Sharingan. Gene. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. I skip a generation.
The dark Hado.
I mean, all Uchihas have Sharingans, so.
That is, no, I mean, that's crazy, because like,
there's no such thing as an Uchiha without a Sharingan.
But the thing is, you got to awaken them, right? You got to awaken.
Yes.
And you got non-fighters that probably haven't had trauma.
Yes, there are probably non-combatants.
I mean, there's like a nigga that was just like fucking spilled hot ramen water on himself. And
then he awakened the Sharingan, right? So it can happen.
That's fucking
the minorest inconvenience.
The one Tome Sharingan.
Right, there you go.
Easy day.
Yeah, it's like being a little person. You gonna fuck around, become a little person because your mama was a little person. Little
person, so now. Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know, Ryan. I don't think Ryan wrote the movie. I don't know fucking
Ryan
Michael B.
The second one, the third one is the first one that Michael B. is actually directing himself.
Yeah.
That's why you get all the anime references and shit like that.
Right. I heard it was some prison nigga that was in Naruto. I'm like, that sounds like some shit Michael B would come through. Did you see the music video where Michael B was basically worshiping that white woman?
No, I did not. I did not.
Not a good look for Michael B. You should probably check that out.
I got to go take a look. But I mean, again, you know, nothing wrong with worshiping white women in all ways and shape forms of fashion. You should worship.
No comment.
Worship in general, you know.
No comment. That-
Said, nah, can't talk on that. Can't speak on the interracial. Hey, no.
Won't speak on it.
No need to. I will for you. I've been one. I live this. I do this.
Oh, do man. You scared enough. If it ain't snowing, man.
I ain't going.
If it ain't snowing, I ain't going. Me, nah. MLK, Jordan Belfort.
Yeah,
if it ain't snowing, I ain't going.
But nah, like, but Dreamville handled it. And honestly, the soundtrack's banging. Banging, like I'll be like, again, the Adonis interlude. That's the first thing when I realized. I was like, holy shit, that's J. Cole. Because literally that same day I was talking about, I was like, I wonder what J. Cole's got next up. Like, I know we got the fall off and then the off season. Like, we had the off season, now we got the fall off, and he's been talking about what, like, this album and shit. But I'm like, when the fuck is he gonna do it? What's the thing? What they've been working on and shit. And then I find out they did this whole soundtrack. And they got some, like, they got Tierra Whack on that bitch. Fucking,
I love Tierra Whack. She is from Philly.
I do love Tierra Whack, and it was fantastic. She killed it. She represented herself, like, as always. I mean, I've never heard of a bad Tierra Whack bar. Speaking of Tierra Whack, I don't know if you heard, but, like, last year, I think she put out, like, a three-part, like, EP, essentially, and it was all, like, it was rap, rock, and pop. It was all different.
I don't know if I want to hear, I don't know if I want to hear her doing that. Rock?
The rock one was a little, like, rough to get into until, like, I was like, okay, come on, get yourself out the
perspective. I don't know. I think Doja Cat has a natural affinity for rock. She did, like, the Celebrity Skin cover for Hole.
But we know why. We know why.
Is it because she's half white?
You went there. You said
that's it. Crazy. No. That's fucked up. That's fucked up.
You went there. I didn't say that.
That's fucked up. You said that. You've been real. I don't know.
You didn't even let me finish. You didn't let me finish. You said that. All right. I was just gonna say it might be because she spent more time in alternative spaces.
We don't know that.
We do know that because she was in trouble for all the alternative spaces that she was in.
And if you call Sean feet in a racist chat an alternative space, you need help.
I'm just saying that it's way more likely that she got, like, a couple of chats that were like, yo, do you like Oasis? And
I doubt it. I sincerely doubt you go from Oasis to feet.
I sincerely doubt it. You like smashing fucking pumpkins.
Terrifying the hoes. The hoes have not left the room in hours. They are terrified.
Except for Doja, because Doja's the weird one that sticks around.
She is a unterrifiable hoe.
No, she's here for the terror. She's trying, like, I want you to attempt to terrify me.
That's disrespectful. I shouldn't call her a hoe because that's fucked up.
Yeah, I mean, you threw it out there. I wasn't even gonna dwell on it, but I'm glad you decided to catch yourself. We're living in a different time. We're living in a different world where niggas is really out here trying to be aware of whether or not, you know, you're hurting niggas' feelings, offending motherfuckers. We've been good about this, man. We're so good at this.
Yeah,
so
we try. Anyway, how was the movie, man? Was it good?
Okay, so I'm gonna put it out.
Good. I don't think it's good. I ain't watch it though.
We always say the words good. Like, I'm like, was it good? Nah, I'm like, was it an interesting movie to watch? Yes. Was the plot thin at times? Absolutely. But it's a fucking.
Why was it thin? Wait, what do you mean by
movie.
It was thin?
It's a boxing
movie. It's a boxing movie, but all boxing movies for the most part are pretty decent.
But that's what I'm like, are they? That's what I'm saying. It's a boxing
Southpaw movie. Is a terrible Southpaw story.
Fucking great movie, though.
But it's a great movie.
Great movie. Jake Gyllenhaal just sitting there, just fucking beat the fuck up, bloody, just like,
not my wife. Not my wife.
Oh, baby, hold on, man. I gotta, you know, do my cuts real quick.
One of the niggas who has some of the worst technical boxing ability ever, but
they keep casting.
Was rooting for that nigga.
They keep casting this nigga as motherfuckers that fight. He's in the new Roadhouse. They're rebooting Roadhouse.
Good for Jake.
He's rebooting Roadhouse. I think the night that fucking Israel Adesanya got knocked out, or it might have been the night that John Bones Jones beat the dog shit out of motherfucking Cyril Gane or whatever the fuck, the Frenchman. Like, one of those nights, Jake Gyllenhaal, like, had a whole opening. Like, people didn't even know what was supposed to happen. Cameras everywhere. They filmed this whole scene for Roadhouse. And I'm like, wait. Roadhouse is an MMA story.
That's right, now it is. That end of watch two, watch this. That's gonna be a good one.
The nigga that had the knife in his eye is back. He's wearing an eye patch.
That's right. He's wearing an eye patch. Like, look here, Watchman. I don't remember his name, the fucking movie. Watchman. We need you again. Y'all kill my partner. We have a new partner.
Michael Pena's back.
It's like a clone of Michael Pena.
Well, no. Oh shit, I forgot Michael Pena.
He died. Spoiler alert for fucking in the watch.
Jake Gyllenhaal was the one that died, but it wasn't. It was Michael Pena because he just had
a They came and they fucking murked that nigga.
But oh, God, it was so fucking awful. Oh my God, that movie was fucked up.
You know, I almost watched that bitch for free. In 2012 when it came out.
Yeah, I did. I love how I was. How did you
know? Like, at the time when we still cared about military PR, they tried to, like, they would show us movies for free and be like, here, come get rock hard watching this fucking movie about brotherhood. So you all hyped up to kill.
You ready to fuck? The morale will be fantastic.
Yeah, let's get that morale up. Look at them. Look at these homies. Look at him. He's a playboy, but he was married.
Look at him fighting a nigga from Training Day.
Yeah, right. Look at him boxing and shit. He was the nigga from Training Day. Yeah, I just told a nigga he was like, that's the nigga who was sitting there. Terry Crews was in Training Day.
Terry Crews is looking hard. He's the one that takes the gun. Nah, go on, man. Nah, go on. We got this.
You think that was pre or post molestation?
I think that's like right at prime molestation, because there's
molestation is not a joke, but also it's not Terry Crews. When you're
Terry Crews, he grabbed my dick.
You let him.
My career.
What was I supposed to do? Let my career? I'm pretty sure if a nigga tried to grab my shit, oh, he is donezo.
I guarantee you, Terry,
he's donezo.
You could have went to Tyler Perry and got a job.
Tyler Perry would have hired Terry Crews for sure.
Every day, all day. Terry Crews would have been dark evil nigga like three times, and then finally got a hero role.
I don't know. He just seems like a real nice nigga.
But look what they did to him in Training Day.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
But he was flipping pigeons, man.
I must have recently watched Training Day.
No, nigga, I just love Training Day.
That nigga was up there clapping. What like the fuck?
Who the fuck has the pigeon flipping Training Day? That's the movie I want to see. I want to see a nigga fucking train.
The movie where he learned how to flip pigeons?
Exactly. Like the mentor, the pigeon flipping mentor.
Yo, I've been always confusing. If there's a nigga out there that's from California, they can explain why everybody, like somebody in the neighborhood, knows how to like control pigeons. Like, please let me know. The pigeon juju cannot be.
Is this like the Michigan gene that you're born into? Like you just wake up and it's like, oh, the new
pigeon. Yeah, the pigeon flipper gene.
The pigeon,
right? I think you have to die like the previous pigeon flipper has to die for the new pigeon flipper to come back, and then you train that pigeon flipper, and yeah.
It's like, no, hey, look, man, that's Dolores over there, all right? She's a little temperamental, right? But you got to give her a shot of hitting,
yeah, right?
Boom,
and then right,
ready to go.
Yeah, there's Hennessy in the beak.
Nah, that's fucking wild. But Creed 3, nigga, no. Again, I said the plot was thin, but the thing is that literally it's like, all right, we know from the first Creed that he spent some time like not home. Like he was out here and like living life. He was born to another woman, so it wasn't like he had the rich life and nobody was claiming him as Apollo Creed's son, right? So he had a homie.
No, his name was Adonis. Come up.
They both boxing.
Yeah, right.
They were both boxing when they were little, and homie was supposed to be like, he's a.
Some cities are like that. You know what I mean?
I mean, it's Philadelphia. They were both in Philly. Wait, no, was it Philadelphia?
It's Philly.
Yeah, because it had to be Philly because the nigga was Apollo Creed's son and he was, you know, out of Philly. Either way. But yada yada, my nigga, they have a fucking traumatic incident, blah blah blah. There's a bunch of bullshit that happened before he got to the money and shit, and blah blah blah. Big nigga, Jonathan Majors' character takes the fall, goes to jail.
What does that mean, take the fall? What was he doing? What did he go to jail for?
So, like, essentially, he went to jail because he had a gun. Like, he
was
like,
trapping. Gotcha.
No, wasn't trapping. Basically, somebody, like, fuck it. Y'all know what we do about spoilers. Fuck y'all. Spoilers.
Hey, man, y'all want to click on this.
If y'all want to go watch that movie, you can. If you don't, or if you want to hear it, fucking send me explain right here. Guess what? Stick around.
I ain't doing no timestamps.
Yeah. No, it's okay. Just like, you know, if you start hearing about Creed 3, you want to not do this, you know, skip forward. Like, 3 minutes. This is gonna take no time. Like, so no time at all. So deadass, my nigga, like, he was like, when he was young, they were at the group home. The nigga that was in charge of group home beat the dog shit out of both of them all the time. He would just beat the shit out of them. And another fucking Creed
grown, like, nigga, like, just a
grown
random kid.
He's like a grown nigga that was like their caretaker or whatever.
I got
like,
some boxes.
I did a job right just like that. I did a job not beating kids. That was like,
yeah, no, you would never.
Exactly. You take kids from disenfranchised areas, fucking not orphans with goddamn, you know, wars of the state, different shit.
Yeah, like, disenfranchised youth.
Yeah, exactly. You take care of them. Now, some niggas are assholes and do horrible shit to kids, and that's fucked up. So that's what happened, right? So basically, they get out of the home. They're old enough to get out the home. They see the nigga that beat them on the corner, right? And he's on the corner and they're like, man. So fucking Lil Creed gets mad. He's like, fuck that nigga. So he goes over there and start beating the dog shit out of homie. Fucking him up. So then his fucking old niggas homies see him beating the shit out they dude. So they grab him. They start fucking him up. So then Creed's homie, Jonathan Majors' character, shows up and he's like, hey, get the fuck off him. And he has a gun. And so he's like, yo, back the fuck,
up.
He's like, everybody get off my nigga. You be woo. And then the cops show up, right? The cops show up. That my nigga had a gun. They were like, yada, yada, who the fuck? And then Creed takes the fuck off. He runs, right? And Jonathan Majors goes down because he, you know, wasn't running. He wasn't smart. He didn't decide to run. He had a gun on him, so he didn't want to get shot. That's how niggas, that's what happens. Like, if you got a gun on, you don't run. That's just, yeah, it's just how that goes. He was smart, nigga. He went to jail, did his bid, right? Gets out as an older dude. He's in his 30s. Like, in his late 30s and shit. So, you know, that's a late age for a boxer and shit. Basically, he gets out there. He meets up with Creed. Like, he's like, he's sitting on his car outside the gym or some shit like that, or outside a restaurant. Yeah, outside the gym or some shit. And they're like, oh shit. They catch up. Creed's like, yo, you know, you say you still want to fight? Well, fuck it, man. Come on down to the gym. I got somebody. Cause he got this champion nigga. So they at this fucking artist party because he got invited to this artist party. Kehlani's there. She's singing and shit. While that shit happens, the
what song was she performing?
Which one of fucking it's actually on
one of the ones for the movie.
Yeah, it's actually on the soundtrack. Is it called Doing My Best? Going Under. I think it's called Going Under.
She didn't do FWU.
Fuck you, nigga. That's
whack. That's my shit.
Yeah, get the fuck out.
That's my shit. Kehlani do FWU.
This nigga here is
wild. Is right? Oh, wait, no. What she do?
No, it's called Shadows. It's called Shadows. That's the name of the song, which is crazy. Like that.
Bring me Distractions and Kehlani back.
Either way. But yeah, so yada yada. During this album party and shit like that, motherfucking me, the other champion nigga is attacked. His tan's fucked up. Like, the funny thing is, the other champion nigga was the bad guy from Creed 2. It was the Russian. Like, the Russian son.
Damn! Oh no! What type of shit you did to win a boxing match?
Fucking shit! I put some grease underneath my wraps, and then I just
take the grease, yeah,
put it in the ass.
I don't know, nearly enough. Okay,
yeah,
okay.
There's a lot of different ways.
But is
yada yada whoop.
Okay, so where does Michael B show up, man?
That's what I'm saying. Michael,
why are we fighting?
The reason he's fighting is because fucking homie beat right there next to him. That's
very crazy. Where's Sylvester Stallone? Where's Rocky?
Oh, Rocky is not in this one. Rocky is back in Philadelphia. You remember he had cancer. He can't travel. They're in L.A. Like they moved to L.A. Because remember in the second movie, they're talking about moving to L.A. and shit. That was kind of a thing.
So there's no Rocky.
Yeah, because his mom.
I have no interest in watching this movie.
Yeah, I mean, it's not about Rocky. That's the thing. It's about.
Yeah, but I don't give a fuck. I got to see Rocky. Like, what good is a Rocky movie? Excuse me, a Creed movie or a Rocky verse movie?
Because
when Rocky not there to be like,
it's not Rocky. It's not Rocky. I actually saw a recent online thing. It was pretty cool. It was a theory. It was like technically, Rocky is not a Rocky story. It's about Apollo Creed. Apollo Creed is the
central. I don't give a fuck if it's technically anything. I just need to see
Apollo Creed is the central like through line of all the Rocky movies.
Got it. Wait, all you said all
except for five.
Get the fuck out.
All right, look, the first one. Apollo Creed gives Rocky the shot, right?
Cool.
So now he's able to actually fight and, you know, be a champion, even though he's like fucking an amateur, essentially. He gives the underdog a shot at the fucking title. He gets the title, right?
Get off this movie's dick. Is it good?
I'm just saying, it's decent. I had a good time.
You would watch it again.
There was moments I cried, shit like that.
It's a boxing movie. If you don't cry at the boxing movie,
then that's what I'm saying. That's like it hit all the fucking checked all the boxes for a boxing movie. I was like, okay, cool. It has all the boxes. When we get to the final fight, though, this is where I find the most issues. Like, right? Like all the montages and shit are uplifting and things like that. The final fight. Oh, yeah. The final fight situation is like there's a lot of weird, like, pausing. Like, whereas in the Rocky movies, like, right, we're fighting. There's 12 rounds of fighting. There's montages, the corners. There's corner scenes and shit. Like, when you go back, you're like, this is what the round was like.
Look, man, you got a mean right hook.
Listen, Rock, you got to go to the body, right? You got to go to the body.
You got to open them up. You can't. You got to make them come into your brain. You got to give it. If he steps right, you need to go left.
When he goes high, you go low.
You go low.
And you stay there. You got to get out of the corner, man. You got to stay
look
out
here,
of the
kid. Corner. You're letting them run the ring on you. You can't get away from those ropes.
Hey, box them in. Box them in. All right?
You got to box them in. That's control what they call the
ring.
Box.
This your ring. That's your this ring.
Your ring.
He's just a visitor. Now, yeah, you right. Take him sitting there packing.
That nigga beat my ass.
Rocky, I don't know what I could do. So much spit in a fucking boxing. Yeah. So much spit. Spit and blood. But
if you let the ref see you bleeding like that, he's going to stop the fight.
Stop the fight. So hold on, man. I'm going to get the fucking WD-40. From
right. That's why I like the fight night games. The fight night games had you like, nah, close that shit up.
You got to make this shit work, nigga. If you don't, you're fucking done. All right. Fight night was fucking amazing, man. I still like bring another fight night out, man. I'm tired of these MMA grands. Like, I want another fight night, but give me another round four, like the with motherfucking crazy stories and shit, where you gotta go to prison, fight dirty and racist.
You think you're a tough guy, eh?
Fight night.
You think you're a real tough guy, eh?
Oh, but nah, because like deadass, they went the same. That I like that fight night because it went the same route as like NBA Street and different shit like that, where it eventually got to the or well, not NBA Street, but like man, 2K got to the point where it was like, yo, you got your own like roster and you go play online and different shit. But either way, blah.
Are you
blah,
trying
blah.
To compare Street and 2K?
To a degree.
I don't play a lot of fucking sports games, man.
I don't even really think that Street ever gave you that was Icon, NBA Icon or something like that. Street Icon.
No, not Phenom. NBA Ball.
Phenom, that's it.
NBA like, Ballers. Phenom. I'm like, all right, I hear you.
Ballers was fucking great. Great series. Great series. I'm not even a basketball nigga. Like, those are fun. Like all the random
EA Big or some shit.
All the random fucking like ports and mods and shit like that during the time frame where like EA was just throwing sports out there. I think it was
EA Big where they were doing like extreme
exactly they were doing random crazy fucking mods.
Yeah, I like those games. I don't give a fuck about sports games like that.
Give me the fucking XFL Blitz type shit.
Yeah, I like NFL, not Blitz. I don't like Blitz. They was doing like steroids and shit. Like NFL, that was
wild.
NFL fucking what the fuck is it called?
Street, nigga. Like
NFL Street. I like NFL Street.
Fucking crazy.
FIFA like, Street. That's good.
You talking about A&1 moves in NFL? I'm running off the sides.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh yeah.
Either way, during the final fight, like they have fights, but rather than the corner scenes and shit like that, you got these random things where like we're inside the motherfuckers' minds and they're fighting, and there's jail bars and lights are changing and shit like that. And I was like, did you watch Blind Spotting?
Yeah.
All right. So you know the portion where that nigga's having a nightmare and it's fucking his fucking white friend not Colin.
Like whatever his name is.
What's his fucking name? Now, Colin is the nigga. Like,
I just like making up names.
What is his fucking name? Rome? Something like that. Either way, the white dude is up there giving a speech to the court and shit like that. It's got that vibe. It's got like a lot of like random, like fucking top down perspective.
Right. This is real. Like, is it real type shit?
Yeah, exactly. Like, this is happening in their minds. And yeah, like, basically them dueling with the demons and shit like that that's going on with their past.
I'll skip it.
And how
you recommend Michael B as a director.
I will say that, yes, I would recommend Michael B as a director. The touching moments were great. Touching moments were really good. The montage is really good. The final fight, I feel like, is where we got the...
And this is not informed at all by you being homeless light at the time.
It did make movies better. Like, it did make us like, oh, wow, I'm not at the house. I'm not on an air mattress. This is great. But deadass, I was watching and I thought, so... Where they threw the fucking anime shit in works better than it looks. Like the way I was seeing it, like with people clipping it and shit like that, I was like, oh, like they do the side by side comparison. Like this is like the punch that Goku did on somebody.
I have not seen any of the
clips. Double knockout. Like that. These are the things that were floating around for a while. Like people were just taking these clips and like, this is what the comparison is essentially. Like I was like, this looks lame. That's kind of lame. I don't know if like how they're going to actually set these up like as actual like punches and fights and shit like that, because, you know, it's a technique. It's a technical fighting, like, sport and shit, so I don't necessarily know if we're gonna fit these in like it without it being comedic. And it wasn't. Like there were moments where I was like, okay, well, I can kind of suspend my disbelief. The double knockout is a little, not the double knockout, but the double face punch is kind of like, eh.
Yeah, right.
The I was like, ah, punch. Was a little cheese.
You know, I started watching Hajime no Ippo, and they do that in one episode where he fights the black dude Jason Ozuma, and he like does a simultaneous punch because he realizes he can't fucking out pace him or whatever. Is like
he can't counter him, so he's gotta go.
You're not faster than him, so what you gotta do is you gotta stop him in your tracks. I'm like, wow. You're right. That's the side point.
You're so right. I like that you're getting into Hajime Ippo, because like I like combat animes, I like fighting animes. Like I'm a Baki Hama fan, I'm a fucking King and Ashura fan. I like that, like Ragnarok. I like, you know, shit that's just kind of fighting out of the blue. So when you got shit like Hajime Ippo, where it's all fucking boxing, but it comes at it from like a sports anime type vibe. Like, okay, right. Because cool. I mean, boxing is a sport.
It is indeed like, a sport. I think that anything that treats boxing as a sport and not per se as a fighting style is pretty fucking good.
Yes, because we all can acknowledge that a nigga throwing kicks versus a nigga throwing a bunch of like, you know, barrage of punches and weaves is typically the nigga that is using all of his body is probably going to win. Like
I mean look,
you're fighting with 50% of your body.
I'm not the combatant here. Okay. My favorite thing to do nowadays is to come up to niggas that obviously work out and ask them if they're functional athletes. Them niggas get mad as fuck.
Nah, bitch, I just look good.
Like, yeah, no, right. Well, I mean, if you're just here for physique, then be happy. But yeah. Shout out to Creed. I'm not watching Creed
3. I understand.
I'm gonna get around to it when it happens.
That was a long ass fucking thing, but maybe that was that longer than 3 minutes? It was definitely long.
It was pretty long.
All right. Yeah. If you made it here, man, we're done with Creed. Like, yeah, look, you made it. Perfect skip. You did it. Like, here we are. We already moved around. Now we watched Creed, watched the new Dungeons and Dragons movie. I'm so excited about that I have like millions of opinions on that. I definitely plan on making a video about that, so I'm not going to give too much here. Just know I enjoy myself. That's going to be the main portion of that. John Wick 4, saw that shit, but that was just pure D, like brain.
It's John Wick, nigga.
Yeah, I just wanted to show up and watch fucking Keanu Reeves shoot people. Literally, I want to watch him say guns a bunch. I want to watch him shoot people, and I want to watch Lawrence Fishburne play one of my favorite characters. I want to D&D. I want to play that nigga in like a fucking role playing game so bad. The fucking Bowery King. That's my favorite character in like action movie history. That shit's amazing. I'm just thinking that rules the underground and all the.
I don't give a fuck about John Wick. Period. I was I was watching Matrix 4 the other day.
And you I was like, watch that shit.
Yeah, I don't give a fuck about it, to be honest with you. It wasn't really for me.
Are you saying you liked New Morpheus better?
I don't know if I like New Morpheus or if I like Trinity as the other one or none of the other.
Oh
shit,
yeah, because now she is the other one.
Yeah, the other one. I don't know. I just wasn't fucking with it. I was like, hey, all right, whatever.
No, speaking of crazy wild shit, man. Like, so during that time frame, I was also, of course, keeping up with shit. Nigga, did you know that Scott Pilgrim is coming back? That was a Netflix series.
That's good. I'll watch that.
Yeah, no, and all the main cast, all the main cast from fucking the Scott Pilgrim movie are reprising their roles for the animated series, because it's going to be an animated series that follows the manga. So it's going to be it's animated.
I didn't know it was animated.
Yeah, no, it's not going to be like a...
That changes things.
Yeah, nah, I don't think they could get their faces. I don't think they'd pay for their faces. Like, Brandon Ruth
is... I would rather you hire other voice actors than try to reprise that.
So with the way I love Neo Yokio, right? With the way I love Neo Yokio, I was
one
like...
One of my favorites.
Because the thing was, sometimes it's very difficult when it comes to some bigger names, right? That outside of, like, animation, right? Bigger names outside of animation doing roles that are animated, right? Because sometimes, like, Desus and Mero as his homies, like, right? When I heard about it,
Solomon Gottlieb, yeah.
Yeah, when I heard about it, I was like, I don't know how that's gonna do. Like, I don't know how that's gonna work. Cause like, I remember Wyclef Jean as a bird. Like, I remember that nigga in Rio, and I was not like untoo impressed, right? But I also was like, I'm privy to Tyler the Creator and fucking Childish Gambino in Cartoon Network shows, so I wasn't necessarily like, I wasn't trying to close my mind too much to it. But this shit seems exciting because one, it's the telling of the manga, so like we get.
It's a comic, nigga.
Let's say comic. All right, excuse me.
It's a comic.
It's very much a comic. Yeah. I don't know why. I guess because it's in the manga section. Like, they don't put it next to fucking. They don't put Scott Pilgrim next to fucking Batman. They don't put fucking.
Yeah.
Blankets.
That's fair.
Goddamn. Fucking Darkseid or Invincible or anything like that. So they stick it next to all the other. I mean, I guess it has its own indie comics ish section.
It's got manga styling. But it's just not. It's not a mega.
It's not a mega. I will fucking concede that point. It's not a problem. But no, It's gonna follow the comic, which was dope. It's way more adult in some areas, which I feel like in like animation, I feel like we're gonna get some cool stuff because it's Netflix, so you know it's gonna get a little raunchy. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited about that shit. But also, it got me thinking. I was like, God damn, Seven Deadly Exes. I mean, this is gonna be a new generation of motherfuckers that are like exposed. Two Scott Pilgrim as far as that goes, and I'm like, damn, how's this gonna affect the fucking? Because I remember how Scott Pilgrim like hit the fucking universe or hit the fucking culture, and it kind of exploded out. You know, like
tell me about that. What does that mean? What do you mean by that? Like, it hit the universe and like
exploded out
culture. Because okay. I don't feel like the comic itself ever.
Not the comic. I'm talking about the movie.
I don't even think the movie did. I think the movie hit a very specific niche of people.
Yes,
and.
That's what now, I that culture like that. So when I say like hit the culture, I was like, so it resonated so well amongst the people it was targeting, right? Like, not only that, but it also garnered a lot of other people into the fold, right? Mm-hmm. People that, you know, these are the individuals that the OG fucking readers or the OG lovers of the shit were like, oh, they're only here because of the movie, or they're only here because it's trendy now. Like it was so big, it had haters. Like it had a team, as it should.
It should have haters because, like, you know, I mean, you got a bunch of people coming in from outside of the culture, the people who like were here originally.
Exactly. And so, like, that's what I'm saying, is the fandom is big enough to say that it has tears, it has a weight. I'll give it a fandom. Maybe, like, it became a fandom. It had a cult following. Mm-hmm. And so, with that being said, right, this now being, like, fucking 10 years removed from the movie, almost, like, more than 10 years, I think, actually. Mm-hmm. Yeah, now more than 10 years removed from the
it's
movie.
About 10. It's yeah. like 13 at this point, honestly.
I mean, we watched it. Yeah, I was like 13, 14. Like, I was like,
it was like 15, 16.
Yeah, I was like 16. Either way, like, you know, definitely more than 10 years. And so it's been over a decade since it's been out, right? And so this is a new group of individuals that this could even like target. This is going to go out to, like, yes, that I feel like a lot of these individuals are already aware of Scott Pilgrim, right? Mm-hmm. As far as the comic, right? And things like that.
Yeah, this is the opportunity to tell the story like from the actual comic. You know exactly. what I mean?
And
this is not saying that the movie, because I think that's what makes it interesting. Like, the movie is 100% like a different entity than the comic. I mean,
absolutely. It's a whole different beast.
Mm-hmm.
The vibe.
I'm not saying I don't even think that the
there are characters that play way more bigger, like way more important roles than they did in the movies.
Debatably more important. I think that everybody had the same general like character or whatever, right? But I think like the movie is just it's its own thing.
Yeah, no, I get it.
You know what I mean,
they gutted some characters, but I mean, not gutted.
I wouldn't say gutted. They just boiled down certain characters to their bare bones.
Okay, but I mean, you know what? I'll
get it. I don't want to sit here and pretend like Scott Pilgrim is one of the fucking deepest stories in the fucking world. I like it. It's one of my favorites, but it's not one of the biggest stories. It's not one of those types of stories.
I mean, I'll give that up. I'll say that as well. But what I will say is this, is that cult following and shit like that, I feel like has now have like an opportunity to explode even more and have more education to the people who are like movie only. Right. Or like, this is also an opportunity for the niggas that were comic book only people to like kind of come out the woodwork and have their opportunity to kind of talk about the things that they've been like brewing over or dealt with over the last 10 to 15 years and how these opinions have matured and things to that degree. Like it puts the fucking, what's the name of the nigga that wrote this?
Brian Lee O'Malley.
That's it. Brian Lee O'Malley. Like it puts this nigga right back out into the front forefront in a world where the social media is way more prevalent. And like the kind of desire to know more about the situation is even deeper. And because information is more centralized, I'm like, how do we get like, what's the fandom look like now? Like once these start coming out, I can guarantee you that the marketing for this is going to get huge. Like we're going to have new Hot Topic shit. We're going to have new fucking like memes. We're going to have new stickers.
I genuinely believe that it's going to do worse in the movie. And the movie didn't do good in the first place.
So like, what I'll say about this, right? It's that Netflix, right? Their animation wise, I'll say this. They're coming off a pretty good year with Cyberpunk Edgerunners kind of being like the what people would say. Actually, it did. It won Anime of the Year for that. It won Anime of the Year, and that's coming out of Netflix. Like, that's pretty fucking crazy because, again, Netflix and animation has not always been the best. But given that, right, I'm like, maybe the studio has had an opportunity, the people that they're working with have had an opportunity to try to like hone their shit a little bit more, and that the production on this product could be crazy because they redid Bee and Puppy Cat, which has like a huge following. And people
did they redo Bee and Puppy Cat or did
yeah,
they just
made
put,
it more,
they just take the series that was on fucking Cartoon?
No, Hangover. They redid it. My girl's an avid Bee and Puppy Cat fan. There's a lot of shit that's different. There's things that are being like more more exposition is happening with these things, like shit's not out of order but in different orders so that it's differently. It's like, so basically they didn't just take the webtoon and like move it over. They literally went through and like the studio went and redid it, and so like they retold like some of the story bits. So that's why I'm like, sometimes people are using these things as opportunities to take works that they've had forever and like tweak them or like add different things. And so like if you take shit like I've been on an Invincible kick, right? I didn't know that Robert Kirkland, the nigga that wrote like Invincible, right, The Walking Dead. I didn't know that Robert Kirkland, when he was doing The Walking Dead TV show, was using moments in the TV show to like adjust his story, like to make things more simpler.
And if you're a bit like available to do that, yeah, that's possible.
Exactly. And so that's what the one thing I'm kind of thinking about with Brian and Lee O'Malley is that, like, given that this is going to be an adaptation of the comics rather than like a retelling of the movie, it's like, what are we getting that's going to be different? Are we going to keep some storylines? Are things going to be tweaked? Like, like everybody's here. We've paid these high class, we paid the actors to come back. Like, so what are we doing? Is it going to be different? Like, how different are we going to make
it? And I don't want to sound like I'm being
The thing is that you're always going to get the positive take from me. I'm typically going to be fairly open-minded. So the thing is that
Don't think this will do well, only because, like, one, what Scott Pilgrim means to other people, like people who weren't there at the time, is not what it is. Also, what it means to Brian Lee O'Malley, you know what I mean? We turned it into an allegory. We turned it into a cautionary tale. We turned it into a lot of things. True. I can't confirm or deny whether or not that's
what his intention was with making
this. You know what I'm saying? Like, I can look at this and be like, he wrote this story, but it's obvious that this nigga, you know what I mean? It's like The Room.
Yeah.
In some regards.
It's like, how can we dive into fucking Wiseau's brain? Like, what was his actual intention? In like disaster movie, again, was a parody and it was kind of like a telling. But the thing is that there's no full, Tommy Wiseau signs off on some of that because he was available to work, didn't help. Right. But not. And I think he was even in the movie at one point, but like at some point. So he was definitely like countering shit that happened. Obviously, nobody wants to be portrayed in a bad light. So I get it. Like, we have taken that story and molded it into
what we wanted.
Exactly.
Not even what we wanted to be, but it's just like what we interpret it to be.
That's what I'm saying. Like, the art is subjective. So like the thing is that if a fan, especially when it comes to like a fandom situation, is that like once something comes out, when something drops, like I think we had this conversation. Well, we loosely had this conversation with like a couple of other people. It was like, who technically has the right to call it what the fuck it is. Like, is it the creator or is it the audience, right? And a lot of times the ending factor, right, is the audience, is the masses, right? So they are going to have the loudest voice in the room. So typically that is going to be like the most accepted thing. And then you will have the not tryhards, but you'll have the diehards. You'll have the people that are like, oh, I'm like plugged in or I'm tapped in. And they'll be like, actually, it's this, or like in all factualness, like it's actually, this is the way it's supposed to happen.
Yeah. But who's right for real? I think the only person who can really determine that it is the creator themselves. And even then, if the fan base or the people who like the consumer decides it's something else and it's popular enough, it doesn't fucking matter what the creator thought.
Weird thing about that is that I'll put this in like not perspective, but I'll put this out there. Like, so look at John Green, right?
Fuck that nigga, man.
I know, right? I know you hate that nigga. And honestly, I don't like his shit.
Fuck the Grammys, nigga.
I'm tired of hearing about dead kids. Like, I just don't want to read this shit. I was just not here for it. That was not my thing. But either way, like, if you look at John Green, John Green wrote these books. They exploded into movies. He got popular into YouTube. Like, not popular. I'll say, like, he got into YouTube and shit like
that. Yeah, he leveraged his fan base.
Exactly. He leveraged the fan base from the books. He was a very participatory, like, person in, like, that. Like, when it came to his story, when it came to this stuff. So I feel like when it came to, like, because he was so active and trying to make sure his voice was heard, he had the opportunity to try to take head of his work as far as it went to the masses and shit and become the nigga that defined his work. But you got a nigga like, you know, George R. R. Martin, right?
Looking for people who didn't get a chance to define their work.
No, I would say he has to a degree. Like, yeah, I don't think that the masses let him define his work because
Show determined.
Exactly. The TV show became the thing and the writers for that became the people.
I would say The Walking Dead.
Yeah, and the reason I even brought up Robert Kirkland, good circle back, because like Robert Kirkland, again, just used that as an opportunity to like take his story and kind of like tweak it where he wanted to. Because the thing about that is I found out that he just like, when it came to The Walking Dead, like when he was ready to end it, he kind of walked in and was like, all right, cool, man, we're done. This is going to be it. Like we wrap it up right here.
And I'm
like,
Carl, he's happy. We're done.
There it is. And so, yeah, look, Carl's happy. Judith is here. I know Judith's a TV only character, actually, I think. I don't think she actually makes it. No.
I don't know. I don't give a fuck about
I didn't read the comics as much.
Yeah.
I quit reading like right before prison because I was like, ooh, prison.
Yeah, I don't give a fuck about this.
Either way, I'm excited. I'm excited to see where this goes. I'm excited to see
how this goes. I mean, they're doing the same thing with like Harry Potter too, right?
Yeah, but that's
gonna make a Harry Potter series
dog shit. That's gonna be a pile of shit.
I don't think so though.
They're retelling the books. It's just
I'm cool with that.
But here's the deal, right? All right.
I think that's different than fucking Scott Pilgrim because it's just like you have so much stuff that like legitimately does not get put in.
I get that. I will agree with you there that there are a lot of things and characters that could be fleshed out and shit that just didn't happen in the movies because they just didn't have time. But I'm like, honestly, I would have just preferred you guys just put out an extended edition, like just put out a fucking Harry Potter extended edition with all the deleted scenes compiled in there or some shit and then keep it rocking. But I don't know. I'm willing to see how this shit goes. I don't even know who's heading the project. I don't know who's fucking like working on it. And then on top of that, like the fucking stink of J.K. Rowling is on that shit. Not that I'm just like, oh, J.K. Rowling, the baddest, the worst bitch in the world, the wicked bitch in the fucking East. But I don't think that's the case. I'm just like, I'm a Harry Potter fan.
I would never call myself a Harry Potter fan, but I am very aware.
I'll say I'm a Harry Potter fan because I took all that time to read all the books. I took all that time to be very ready to like check those out when I was younger. And so what I can't say is that like,
so you're a shower masturbation fan too?
Always, like, of course, like,
oh, you're sick.
The water.
I just did that because I had to.
My body.
We're going.
I mean, it's an easy place. You're private. Like, nobody's coming in. Like, the water.
You're right.
Like,
if I can hide it like this.
No, it's way better though if you just sit on the toilet. I don't know why people.
Yeah, right. Reclining over everything.
Now, every time, like, stand up.
Standing.
Like,
what the fuck's wrong with you?
Are you not an adult? I don't like standing head. No, man, she was all right, man,
all right, now it's too. No, I won't speak on this. Anyway,
this is past stuff. I'm not.
I won't speak on this. Period. I won't speak on
it. Hey, get in the comments, motherfuckers. Tell me.
That's a y'all thing. That's a y'all thing.
Now, laid back is always kind of a monster.
Moving on. Anyway, I think that Harry Potter, the series, will be better than the movies, personally, for me.
Okay. All right. So with that being said, if that's the statement, then yes. But I feel like the only reason I would say that is because it's like, okay, cool. It's better than the movies because of more information. That would be my only real like thing about it. Like, okay, this is better because I'm learning more, or not learning more, but I'm seeing more fucking put out there. This is why I can watch a spinoff series of fucking Game of Thrones. I'm like, again, I read the spinoff books too. So I'm like, I guess that's the same situation there, which I had a fucking blast watching Fire and Blood. You know, shout out to them.
Right.
Fucking fun.
I get it. I don't know. Adaptation is hard, and you're never going to make everybody happy. Well,
it's going to be fucking rough. It's going to be goddamn rough. What I'm interested to see is that, does this turn out more awkward niggas? Like, for sure.
I mean, but I think the whole scaring niggas, they're they're never going to die.
No. And I feel
they're
like
they're never going to die.
Some new fucking role model, some new fucking awkward son of a bitch is just gonna be out here, like, or awkward or social norm ignoring motherfucker that's just gonna come swooping out of nowhere and be like, "Ooh, your armpit, let me see it." Oh, yeah, right. Girls in fucking France, they don't shave, and I think that social norms are ridiculous.
Oh. Right, or I just don't read social cues very well. I just think that it's a little bit easier to integrate them into society than it used to be. You feel me?
I mean, the thing is,
I don't think that like being like a mentally or socially awkward dude makes you a whole scarer anymore. I think just being into very specific things without
a fucking filter or without a
without the filter
regulator was like that, you don't have like
a fucking, makes you the whole scarer.
Yeah, it's like, well, the thing is that, look, man, we like the fact that you like Beetleborgs, man. We like that's the fact that you live in a world where Beetleborgs can be a fandom for you and you can enjoy everything about it. We did not all show up at 9 p.m. and stand in line at the bar so we can hear you talk about this motherfucking Beetleborg show from back in the fucking 90s. We didn't show up so that you could take up all our time. We brought you here because we wanted to hang out. We wanted to all have a good time, and we wanted to see some hoes. But no hoes are coming over here because while they're fucking
terrified. 10
to 15 like fucking feet away at the other table or something like that, they hear shit like, and then he pulled out his Beetleborg. I mean,
I would love to see it, man. I think it's cool that they all turned into comic books in between transformations. That's cool.
That's the best transition ever. Did you understand that Fox Kids had the rights to them for a while and they lost the rights?
Right. The only reason that they didn't renew them for a third season was because like the Beetleborgs stock footage changed.
Were you aware that in Forever Red, the Power Rangers, Awesome Super Sentai side quest, the Beetleborgs, their Beetleborg costumes and armor is present
inside of the fucking thing? I actually did not know that. Oh, Either way, you're talking about very specific niche things that are not very welcoming.
Yeah, and that are not welcoming conversation pieces for people that aren't participatory in these niche things. Oh, did you see a motherfucker walk by in a shirt that's referencing something that you know about? Don't stop that person immediately and then go on.
Shout out to the host carriers, man, because they be interested sometimes. But I just
shout out to the host carriers because you're dope to come chill and play video games with. Shout out to the host carriers because you're an awesome car ride friend. Like, if you're just trying to bull.
If I need 45 minutes on a car ride. Oh, yeah.
You're gonna give me this. You're gonna give me the rundown on this. We're gonna have a good time. We're gonna chop it up.
Anything over 45.
Yeah.
It can't happen.
Suddenly it's like,
it cannot happen,
man. Now we want to listen to some music for now. Like, you're gonna have to calm down about your King Kong fact. Right. Yo, man,
it's all just undiagnosed autism anyway.
Appeared first in the 1960s in Japan, you know, reference to Kai, and like, yeah, no, exactly. That kind of shit. I have been notorious as a younger man to be a host here. I've been I was a very acquired taste. I'm still a very acquired taste as like an adult man, like, you know, the thing. But like, and so, yeah, I feel like there are some hoes that would be scared by me. Like, it was like, oh, yeah, I'm not interested in that nigga's energy. Like, he's loud. Like, they might not even hear what the fuck I'm talking about.
He doesn't even know what he's talking about anymore,
man. The general tone and sound of my voice might just be a full turnoff for that individual. And that doesn't even have to be sexual. Just like, oh, no, like, that's a deal breaker. Like, that vibe over there, I don't want that.
I'm not fucking with it.
Yeah, no. And that's perfectly fine. I feel like everybody has their preferences and things to that degree. And if you're a hoe and you're scared, or you're scaring hoes, like, that's your preference. I feel like you should curate your environment. Make sure that you fucking surround yourself with individuals that you fucking feel comfortable around. And you feel like you don't have to watch
curate them. Gots to curate the vibe, nigga.
You know, but the thing is at the same time, is that sometimes, man, you just accidentally bring your whole sheriff, right? Like, you're fucking, and sometimes it's not even a thing that you brought your friend. Like, given the fact that we live in an internet age, nigga, like, that ass, you could be talking to a hoe scare. You could have a fucking whole Discord. There's like 6 hoe scares in there. You don't even know.
You wouldn't even know.
I've just been having a good time chopping that shit up. But then you look at them DMs, and then you're like, oh, shit.
Be in there out of pocket.
Out of fucking pocket. Wait a motherfucking minute. Like, look at Justin Roiland, right?
Beautiful playboy.
Justin Roiland, hilarious, right? I think that nigga's funny. I thought he was funny in G4 Tech TV.
I wouldn't call him funny.
But a little gross from time to time, but like, weird. Funny.
What's your point in saying that?
What I'm saying is this, like, right? We went on this thing about your grades being a piece of shit like that, because we're talking about, you know, his court cases and shit. We know things, but you know, shit got dropped. His case got
But
it doesn't take much to get out of a court case. You got a good lawyer, you got enough money. Sometimes shit can happen. Now, mind you, legally right now, Justin Roiland is in the clear, right? But as far as the court of public opinion, if you look, these DMs, these motherfucking chats that he's got with these people that are underage.
I ain't changing my stance on shit, nigga.
Yeah, that shit's nasty. Nobody. I was like, hey, I see you as a motherfucking, we know what your true colors are. We can't let you fucking go. But, you know, this nigga right here, if you look at these chats, that's notorious hoe scare shit, right? Sometimes that stuff, like, it's like, the thing is that it's not just the fact that they're underage, right? It's the content of the messages themselves. That would be fucking wild if that was a conversation between two consenting adults, like two older adults. That the conversation that he's having with these individuals is wild in the space of like legality. It was like, if this person was like, again, of age,
you're wild regardless.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the vibe that you get from these host carriers and shit like that. Like, I recently, like, again, and niggas all over the place are getting in trouble for this wild shit like that. No, we're not just talking about host scaring. Some people out here legitimately, like, you know, making motherfuckers uncomfortable. I mean, I guess that is host scaring, but like,
it's definitely host scaring.
Recently, like, a nigga in the blurred space, and then
yeah, I'm not touching that, buddy.
Oh no, we're not talking about that nigga.
I can't. White people business. I can't.
Ooh, okay, hold on. I get it, because that's why I said I couldn't necessarily say the blurred space, but an individual that's blurred adjacent, a young black nerd, has been caught out motherfucking, you know, getting in some people's DMs and being a little uncomfortable, man, making some motherfuckers uncomfortable. Also, I mean, we can't not, before we get into that bullshit, because again, we're not going to drop any names or shit like that, get ourselves shot.
Nigga, you can drop his name. Nigga, he already came out and said who the fuck he was.
Nigga. Oh, man, I didn't even look at his reply. I was going to talk about that. I just mentioned that the fact that we just had a whole conversation back then about Jonathan Majors. We didn't address his motherfucking,
domestic violence allegations. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I was just saying that as far as that shit goes, the individual in his fucking case has recanted their statement, gone back on it. And that he was only arrested because they in the state.
They have to arrest somebody. Yes. That is the legal statement here. Yes.
Yeah. The legal statement says, hey, you know, shit, we got to put that away. You know, we got to take somebody. But his lawyer has now come out. They've released text messages and things to that degree with this individual that has allegedly been hurt, recanting statements, you know, checking on individuals. We don't necessarily know if it's his girlfriend. We do know that he knew her. So again, I can't necessarily throw fucking Jonathan Majors away at this moment or at this time, because again, everything's kind of, you know, recanted. But I can't talk about Justin Roiland getting his shit dismissed and being a piece of shit still and not
talking.
Jonathan Major. Without addressing Jonathan Majors, because the thing is that the same thing that went down with fucking Justin Roiland and having all of these messages and shit like that put out there and having other people kind of speak about their experience with him, Jonathan Majors is also having a bit of that. Now, mind you, no messages, no actual record or proof has been put out there yet, by the way. It's just a lot of individuals that are talking about like, oh, well, we've worked with him in the industry and he's a foul, abusive motherfucker. He's a man. He's like, he's just a fucking, he's a piece of work. He's a piece of shit. He's a real man. He's a real man.
Right.
People like that nigga. And so there's like a group of individuals that are saying this type of shit. They have nothing to substantiate their claim. So like, again, I wouldn't
say that there's nothing to substantiate the claim. I would more so say like, hey, there's not anything that's going to stick. Yeah, that's true. Per se.
The word substantiate their claim, it gets too legal. At the end of the day,
with all these legal cases and shit, everything legal, it's a matter of like, what you can prove vice what happened.
Indeed.
You know what I mean? I'm not gonna completely absolve any of these niggas, Jonathan Majors, fucking Justin Roiland, any of the niggas for any of the possible fucked up shit they possibly did.
No.
Because the legal system, they said they was good.
It's true. But
vice versa, of course.
I will say this. Because here comes devil's advocates, right? Devil's advocate, right? Mm. All right, our uncle, right? I'll use our personal life.
Our uncle, okay.
Yeah, our uncle, right? Goes to jail for weed, right?
All right.
Goes to jail for weed, has this on his charge, is kind of a felon forever, right? He does his time, gets out, he lives his life. He's an entrepreneur now because being a felon is hard. Being a felon is hard. But the thing is that very soon it's very possible that Texas might legalize marijuana, right?
Okay.
All right. And with that being said, like, and again, this is something that years down the line, because we just recently shout out to Texas for passing the House passed a bill for the decriminalization of marijuana across the board. But again, we got to make it through the rest of the proper channels and shit like that. That does not mean it is decriminalized. It's not a full right. law yet. But, you know, cool. You know, we're making progress and shit. But what I'm saying is that one day, right, with us making strides like that, unanimous passing, you know, that means that we're working even further and closer to it. So, with 81% of Texas really being in favor of legislation, we might have legal weed, which means that anybody that got in trouble or bullshitted about legal weed, about weed, right? Their shit gets, their records are removed, right? But the thing is that the stink is always there because he was arrested, right? The record of his felony's gone, but the record of his arrest is still there, right? His time in prison is still around. Okay. That individual, like, does that stink follow him forever, even though it's legal now?
It does not, but it's also like depending on what you did.
Yeah, I mean, I get it. Very true. Like, you know, putting your hands on women or like speaking to underage people, like these are things that are much more heinous than like carrying a nickel bag or something like that. Right. I was talking about legal and shit like that.
There's a spectrum that is allowable with like drugs, bro.
Yeah,
and there's not as much of a spectrum when it comes to like domestic violence or, you know, anything sexual in nature. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. I get behind that.
That's why I can't give nobody the pass. We don't know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Just because like legally somebody's been absolved of some shit, I don't know what your fucking lawyers did, and I hope I never find out.
Yeah, I mean, like the thing is that if you got off legally, man, just keep your mouth shut. I don't want to hear about it. Like, don't go write a book. I did it.
And that nigga ain't the niggas. Them both the niggas is not no heroes to me. So
no, I was like, I'm not out here like, oh, fucking Jonathan Majors took a Doflamingo pose. He wore a Dofi fucking boa. That was so dope. Oh, he speaks for the nerds, man. He's here. He's came to conquer.
Who, Jonathan?
Yeah, Jonathan Majors.
That nigga don't speak for me.
No, I'm saying that some people by the fact that he is in some nerd spaces now, like because of the fact that he is Kang the Conqueror, he's the one above all. He's now, you know, in Creed 3, which has been connected and synonymous with like fucking anime and shit to that degree. Michael B. Jordan's involved, and because of the anime references, it's become wrapped into that, right? Like, it's become a situation of like, yes, it is about the hood, yes, it is about that experience, but it also, you know, speaks to a couple of other. It doesn't just speak to the hood niggas. That's the whole thing.
Right.
And so, with that being said, like, I'm not saying that Jonathan Majors is my hero, but I will say that a lot of people were starting to like kind of line him up as like a North Star. like as an individual, be like, yeah, this isn't.
And hey, you know what I mean? If you want to look at him for what his work is, yeah, you can do that. I'm just saying, like, if y'all come up with some more information, y'all better be ready to hang him the same way.
Exactly.
Y'all just
and don't forget that, like, sometimes, like, you if you're gonna separate the two, like, you can talk about the work, but then it was like, you know, don't hesitate to fucking acknowledge the piece of shit person he might be.
Agreed.
Yeah, which I mean, like, again, we made that statement. We made that on wax a couple of times. So we just making sure the niggas know, like, you know, hey, look, you can be a fucking genius and a piece of shit at the same time.
Yeah, no, for sure. For sure. Every it's time. Neither are mutually exclusive.
Not at all. Not at all.
Shit.
Nah, man, as far as that nigga goes in the bar space and shit like that, you know, everybody just be fucking careful. The thing is, man, is that sometimes, motherfucker, everything is recorded. You better watch your motherfucker self. Don't get drunk. Don't get high and think, oh, yeah, I can reach out. Yeah, I'll just go ahead and drop a little funny ditty in there. And then motherfucker be like, nah, you scared the hoes. Now you fumbled the bag. Yo, if you want to get at us in the motherfucking comments and shit like that, it's no problem. We'll happily have a wonderful conversation with you, but I do not plan on fucking up our bag at all.
Please don't.
You ain't gonna catch me fucking slipping. So if you're underage, man, you better holler.
Yeah, all right. Stop talking.
You did say don't get canceled tonight.
Yeah. I know you was going. Just shut the fuck up.
Yeah, sometimes it's okay to let it die. Sometimes it's okay to let it go. Man, it's been fantastic, dog. I've been happy to be back on the mic and shit like that, man. I miss you. I miss having this time here, man. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for tuning into the motherfucking Well-Spoken Token, yo. It's so glad to be. I'm so happy to be back. It's so good to be in our new space. This is not the final layout for the actual studio and things. I do plan on moving things around. So as things change, please bear with me. You know, we're trying to make things happen in this new area, new space. Again, this is all me in here. Like, I'm no longer having to be in the living room staring at my girl while I try to record and shit like that. It's so goddamn nice. What about you, bro? You got your own little area?
Nah, nigga. We share an office now.
Oh, that's what's up. So, like, you and your girl just, like, you got a pod space over there, and then she got a little space over there. That's what's up. You get to live my life for a little while. Like, not just have a dedicated area just to you.
No comment. All right.
Yeah. No problem. But, again, thank you so much for tuning in, bro. You got any fucking final words for the people? Got anything else you want to say, let them know about?
No. I'm here for the rest of the month. Shit.
Hey, exactly. So that means that we're getting work done, baby. We're getting work done. Be expecting more episodes. We'll catch you again on the next Monday, the next episode again. Thank you. It's the Well-Spoken Token. We love you, and we're out.